All right, good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Bible study. It's good to be back with you. It's always a little hard, I guess, to come back from vacation, especially Phoenix, Arizona vacation, though from what I saw, it wasn't that much warmer down there than it was here, but it's always good to come back and be back with you guys, and now I'll be home for a while, so... But good to be back with you. Good to be back getting into God's Word with you. Tonight we'll finish our midweek Bible study on our Old Testament survey. Next Wednesday is Ash Wednesday, so we'll begin with our Ash Wednesday services and continue with our midweek Lenten services throughout the season of Lent. Tonight, as it sometimes goes with studies, sometimes when you get to the end, you maybe don't necessarily have enough to fill an entire hour. So I might not fill the entire hour. We might, too. I did add a little bit of information on the intertestamental period, too. So we'll talk just a little bit about that history that covers that gap of about 430 years from the end of the Old Testament and gets us into the time where the New Testament begins. So thought that might be kind of an interesting history too. But before us tonight, we'll have the books of Nehemiah and Esther, and then that basically takes us to the end. So with that, why don't we begin with prayer? Dear Lord, Heavenly Father, we give you thanks that you have gathered us here together around your word. We pray that you would be with us now, that you would send your Holy Spirit to teach us, that we may understand all the better the unveiling of your plan which brought about your Son, our Savior. Bless this time, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. So, as I mentioned, we are... going to go into the book of Nehemiah today. This is where we left off last time. It was in the book of Ezra. And the books of Ezra and Nehemiah are very much related to one another. Ezra deals with the rebuilding of the temple primarily. Nehemiah is going to deal primarily with the rebuilding of the city itself, the rebuilding of the walls around Jerusalem and the rest of the city. But they were contemporaries of one another. They had very similar roles to one another, as we kind of see. We went through the book of Ezra last time, and there are really two time periods that are dealt with in the book of Ezra. The first six chapters deal with the very first command to go back and rebuild that temple, about 50 years after the captivity started. When we count the 70 years of the Babylonian captivity, we count from basically the time when the temple was destroyed until the temple is rebuilt. And this first going back of some people was kind of a small group. It would be larger groups of people that would come back after, especially in the rebuilding program of Nehemiah, which we'll read about when he starts to rebuild. The people, the Jews, sort of get excited about what's going on there, and they move back in bigger groups then. But so in Ezra, the first six chapters talk about the commissioning of the temple being built. That's the first three chapters. It talks about some of the difficulties then that the people had in some of the opposition they came against, not just in rebuilding the temple, but later on in rebuilding the city as well. But the Lord worked through it, and they were able to complete the temple in about 515 or 516 BC. There, in the book of Ezra, then, is about a 58-year gap. The book of Esther occurs during this time, which we're going to get to at the end of our study tonight. And then chapter 7 through 10, are the actual times in which Ezra lived. This talks about the return, the rebuilding of the people, as you see the focus in that section there. So the return under Ezra, it's more of a spiritual restoration rather than a material restoration. It covers just about 1 year of the time, but it deals with a lot of Ezra leading the people spiritually, leading them back to study God's word. He was a teacher. He was one of the leaders of worship there. So obviously the reason that the Lord allowed it for them to go back and rebuild their city wasn't just so that they could be a physical people there, but ultimately it's the spiritual restoration that the Lord was most concerned with. So that is basically the book of Ezra. Then we go into the book of Nehemiah then, which happens, like I said, at the same time. We're dealing here with rebuilding, the construction of the walls, the completion of the walls takes about 8 chapters. The revival within the walls, and then resettlement within the walls. So you see sort of the same sort of outline that we had for Ezra. We're rebuilding the physical structures in the first half of the book. In the second half, it's rebuilding the people spiritually. So the renewed covenant, religious reform, a renewed nation, political reform. So both books outline in a very similar type of way. All right, so we'll go through our summary then, not quite chapter by chapter. We'll take it in sort of bigger chunks here. So Nehemiah chapters 1 and 2. So Nehemiah recalls the report about Jerusalem that prompted his decision to travel there and assist God's people. On behalf of those struggling in Jerusalem, Nehemiah fasts and prays with great empathy as guided by God's word. Nehemiah asks for an opportunity to help rebuild his homeland, and the king answers favorably because God is guiding the matter. The word moves Nehemiah's heart to begin plans for rebuilding Jerusalem's walls. Nehemiah had been a sort of prominent guy. He is described in the first chapter as being the cupbearer to the king. Anybody know what the cupbearer gets to do?
To taste.
That's right. You get to taste and make sure there's no poison in the cup. And so, certainly would be a very trusted guy. I don't think I'd want that job, but that was Nehemiah's job. And, you know, by doing that, he became a very trusted official within the Persian government. And this is why Nehemiah ends up being allowed to go back. I mean, it's ultimately, again, God working through this whole process, but... Nehemiah's faithfulness and loyalty to the king kind of moves the king to allow him to go back. In chapters 3 and 4, then, the Judeans eagerly begin work on the walls and gates of Jerusalem under Nehemiah's able leadership. When obstacles arise, Nehemiah encourages even more vigilant service by reminding the workers that our God will fight for us. And this is where we come up in these two chapters, some of that opposition that was mentioned in the book of Ezra. If you remember from Ezra chapter, it's right in the same chapters, chapter 3 and 4, it talks about the difficulty with rebuilding the temple, how the people who were in the land there opposed it, how they said, oh, once this people rebuilds the temple, they're not going to want to be under your rule anymore. They're going to revolt. They have the history of doing this. And then Ezra went on into the future from there and talked about all of the opposition that had to do with the rebuilding of all of the city. So this is where Ezra and Nehemiah really are talking about the exact same thing here. So there was this, the people didn't want to see this temple or Jerusalem rebuilt. They probably did know something about the history. There was probably a certain fear of God too, though not the good kind of fear of God, like fear, like terror, afraid of him. And then also that thought, of course, though, that if the temple wouldn't be rebuilt, then God wouldn't somehow be able to function. Just the idea they had. Well, they got that wrong. But So part of Nehemiah's job is to come in and be that encourager, to remind them that God will fight for them, even in the opposition that they face to rebuild the city. Chapters 5 through 7 then. Governor Nehemiah addresses the problems caused by excessive interest rates and taxes and sets an example of generosity for the leaders. However, false prophets attempt to deceive Nehemiah and bring about his death. God's people must always test claims of prophetic authority against the sure word of prophecy, Holy Scripture. Nehemiah appoints faithful colleagues to ensure good progress on the next phase of the work and catalogs the status of the community. So what happens here is Nehemiah is addressing problems. Some of the people don't like it, and so there are these false prophets that are trying to get Nehemiah to go to such and such a place and to set up his death, and basically Nehemiah doesn't listen to them. And so his life is preserved then. Nehemiah then, you know, again, he continues to appoint faithful colleagues to ensure the progress. And so the building goes along smoothly with Nehemiah's guidance and with his reminders again that it's the Lord who's with them. So chapter 7 then really ends kind of the discussion of the physical building up of the city. Nehemiah 8 through 10. Nehemiah's efforts result in an opportunity for Ezra and others to teach God's word to the Judeans. The word moves their hearts, who sanctify the day of celebration by word and faith. By studying scripture, the Judeans learn that they have overlooked celebrating a key feast, the Feast of Booths. The people confess the Lord's enduring mercy promised in the covenant. They were saved by God's grace, not by their obedience. They offer thanks to the Lord for the blessings, for the blessing of the covenant and the atonement provided throughout the through the sacrifices. So the Feast of Booths, it's mentioned in the New Testament too. It's sometimes referred to as the Feast of Tabernacles. It was basically another ceremony, one of the three big ones. And it's another one that was a remembrance of the time of the Exodus and then after that. This specifically remembering the time that they lived in the wilderness, that they lived in tents. And so they would live in a tent for a week, basically, and remember how the Lord had provided for them in the wilderness. So this is one of the big three, and they had overlooked it, and by studying scripture, they reinstated it. And so, you know, Ezra and Nehemiah are teaching God's word, the proper worship is being restored, and this is all a good thing. All right. And then chapters 11 through 13. For the sake of security and good order, a number of people willingly agreed to occupy Jerusalem, which was only the beginning to be restored. With careful organization, the priests and Levites led the people in worship and in dedicating the city walls. Nehemiah confronts ongoing issues of the law and holiness, even losing his composure when people violate the covenant. The book ends with practical measures he enacts. So there are a couple different incidents where Nehemiah is confronting people not living according to the law, and so he confronts them with it, confronts them with God's word, and then Nehemiah really kind of ends, yeah, with sort of a listing of practical things that the people were supposed to do to keep the proper worship. So that's really what Nehemiah is all about. Again, very similar to Ezra, but, you know, the people now are being rebuilt. Granted, it's not the glory that they had back in the days of David and Solomon. They're never going to see that again. But they have their land back, and the proper worship has been restored, and they're at least being ruled by a people who pretty much is happy to leave them alone. This is not always going to be true. But at this point in history anyway, the people are leaving them alone. They're allowing them at least to worship. And while they're not leading as a nation themselves, they're allowed to carry out the things that God wants them to carry out. Any questions on Nehemiah?
Was he a Levite?
He was not, I don't believe. Ezra was.
Ezra was?
Yes, but not Nehemiah. Let's see if I can tell what tribe he was from real quick. Pull up my Bible on here. Should say hello to the people. Should let the people at home see what I'm doing too. It doesn't say in the first chapter here. So I don't know.
That's fine.
Yeah, he wasn't a Levite, though. Yeah, Ezra was.
Okay.
Yeah. Anything else on Nehemiah? One of the shortest guys in the Bible. Nehemiah. There's a groaner for you. Yep. Well, with that, sorry, I didn't bring back any better jokes from Phoenix. All right. So we move to the book of Esther then, and I maybe could have put Esther somewhere in between these. Well, Esther would fit in the middle of Ezra and before Nehemiah, chronologically. So, anyway, so here's Esther then. Anybody know, first of all, what is unique about Esther? It's the only book in the Bible that does not mention
God, I suppose.
Huh? Yeah. Only book in the Bible that does not specifically mention God. Now, it's clear by how things work out, and there are allusions to the fact that it certainly is God that's guiding everything that's going on, but there's no mention of God in the book. We don't have any scripture readings from the book of Esther that are assigned for Sundays. So you probably have never heard a sermon on anything in the book of Esther either. Maybe you have, but it doesn't appear in any of the lectionaries. So, but it's an inspired book. It's in the scriptures. And it shows how God's hand was working, not just in Jerusalem, but also in Babylon. So Esther, the book of Esther does not pick up the thread of history where the two preceding books left it. So Ezra and Nehemiah come right before Esther. But supplements the record of the same century of post-exilic Israel spanned by Ezra and Nehemiah. It tells of events that happened after the rebuilding of the temple, 516 BC, or Ezra chapters 1 through 6, but before Ezra's arrival in Jerusalem, 457 BC, so chapters 7 through 10. Esther does not furnish a continuous chronicle of this half-century. The account is limited to a dramatic episode during the early part of the reign of Ahasuerus, or Xerxes, referred to only in passing in Ezra 4, verse 6. Esther complements Ezra and Nehemiah also as far as the place of action is concerned. The scene shifts from the newly established community in Jerusalem to provinces within the Persian Empire, where many Jews chose to remain rather than return to the homeland, which they would do again, as I mentioned, more so after the city is rebuilt, after some of the reforms that Ezra and Nehemiah had accomplished. The court of Xerxes is the focus here of attention. So, chapter 1, verse 1 through 2, verse 18. Ahasuerus celebrates his ascension, or his accession to the throne, with extravagant drinking parties for government officials and common citizens. That's exactly how it's described. He and his wife, Vashti, are not models of moral virtue for believers, yet God uses the king's dismissal of his wife to allow Esther to become queen. After careful preparation, beautiful Esther meets Ahasuerus, gains his favor, and becomes queen of Persia. Basically what happens in chapter 1 is that the king calls for Vashti because he wants her to come out and he wants everybody at this party to look at how beautiful she is. That's it. And she's not having it, so she just refuses. So these certain advisors come to the king and say, yeah, you need to put her away, or else no woman in all the land will obey their husband. And that's what he does. Just gets rid of her. So?
Does he kill her or divorce her?
No, he just divorces her. He just sends her away. And then he goes on to meet just a number of different women in the city, because he's going to pick one to be his wife, and Esther is the one that catches his eye. So there we go. It's Esther's cousin, older cousin Mordecai, who sort of convinces Esther and helps Esther with advice and such to catch the king's eye, and eventually does. Once we get to halfway through chapter 2, then the story moves to focus on Esther's cousin and guardian, Mordecai. Mordecai's discovery of a plot against Ahasuerus means that the king owes him a favor, which is going to come into play later on. Haman is this, like, he's the second in command, basically, at this time. So Haman's extreme prejudice against the Judeans threatens them with annihilation. Mordecai is shocked by Haman's edict and goes into public mourning. Haman just didn't like the Jews, and so he puts out this extreme edict that the Jews are to be done away with. Hitler wasn't the first one to think of a Holocaust. Haman was way ahead of him. As Esther, of course, being a Jew, gradually comes to realize the seriousness of the situation and pledges her life in an attempt to save her people. It seems clear here, at least anyway, that Ahasuerus doesn't know that Esther's Jewish. And Esther kind of thinks that she's untouchable by this edict, and then Mordecai makes her realize that no, once they find out that you're Jewish, it's there's nothing that's going to stop them from exterminating you either. So she pledges her life, and she proclaims basically a fast for the Jews for 3 days, and says that she will go in and talk to the king, which is against the law, because a woman does not go in and request the presence of a man. This is the way society was. She could be put to death for such a thing. Fortunately, Esther finds favor in the king's eyes, and he does listen to her. So then chapters 5 through 8. So Esther goes in, doesn't make her intentions known immediately to the king and to Haman, but waits for exactly the right moment. Then Ahasuerus, who is unable to sleep, hears Mordecai's good deed and decides to honor him. Remember, that's that good deed before, that Mordecai had heard about this threat against him? Haman happens to arrive at the court just in time to become the king's agent appointed to honor the hated Mordecai. And this is probably the funniest part of the book. It really is kind of entertaining. Because Haman just hates Mordecai. Because Mordecai stands at the gate to the palace, and he doesn't give Haman any respect at all. And Haman, at one point, was complaining to his wife, and he builds this huge gallows that he's going to hang Mordecai from. And so Mordecai is going in to ask the king if he could hang Haman's going in basically to ask the king if he could hang Mordecai. And in the end, he has to honor him because of the great thing that he did for the king. Kind of a twist. There's another twist coming, too. So Haman has hidden from Ahasuerus the full consequences of his murderous plan to wipe out the people of Judah. The king may be deceived, but God is not, and Haman meets his end. And it's clear in here, again, that God is guiding this whole process, even though God isn't mentioned. The other twist that sort of happens here, then, is once Esther basically makes it known what Haman had decided he was going to do with wiping out the people of Judah, he orders that Haman should be hung on the very gallows that he built for Mordecai to be hung from. And Mordecai takes his place. So, and then the relationship between Mordecai and Esther is finally made known to the king, and everything is happy. So there it is. King Ahasuerus then gives Mordecai permission to issue a decree that countermands Haman's decree. The Judeans are given the right to defend themselves if attacked and so take vengeance on their enemies. And so they're protected. When the 13th of Adar arrives, which is soon, actually, the Judeans ably defend themselves. They destroy those who hate them, but take no plunder from their enemies. The festival of Purim is established by Mordecai and Esther to celebrate the destruction of Haman and other Persian enemies. A postscript praises Ahasuerus and Mordecai for providing the people with good government and for seeking their welfare. So the people are provided for while they live in this land. Again, eventually many of them are going to end up going back to Jerusalem, but in the interim they're provided for, and God's hand again is all over this in the book. The festival of Purim is one that is still celebrated today, and while not mentioned in the New Testament, almost certainly Jesus would have celebrated it, because it was a Jewish celebration. The festival of Purim is kind of an interesting thing. They read the Book of Esther during it, and the people are encouraged to cheer when they hear the name of Mordecai. And when the name of Haman is mentioned, they hiss. So, this is the festival. A lot of wine is also involved.
So when was the Book of Esther written? Was it while she was still alive?
When was it actually written? Good question. Probably at some time after. But I don't know. At some time after these events happen, though. Probably not too long after. We don't really know who the author is. Could have been Ezra or Nehemiah. Ezra might be the better choice of those two, but could be either one of them or somebody else. All right. Well, any questions? So that basically takes us to the end of our survey. So we'll put a colorful map on here that's too small to read, and we'll kind of trace through some of this. So here's what we've covered. All the way back in Genesis 1, let me see if the next one looks a little better. Let's use this one. This one's a little easier to see. So, creation, the date that is given to it by Bishop Usher of like about the 4th century, no, maybe it's even later than that, I can't remember. But 4004 BC is what's given for the date of creation. It may be that, it could be maybe within 1,000 years or longer than that. When we look at genealogies from the Old Testament, they're very selective genealogies. At times there are people who are skipped in those. And so we could possibly be dealing with a longer amount of time, but it couldn't be much longer than maybe, you know, the world isn't any more than 7,000 years old. So, but if we just add up the genealogies as they are, you get back to 4004 BC, which is just fine too. So, so that's creation. There's a whole lot of time that goes by. Some 2,000 years go by in the first 11 chapters of Genesis, where you get the whole world populated, you get the whole world destroyed, the whole world repopulated, and then when the people don't want to spread out and they build this tower of Babel in chapter 11 of Genesis, languages get confused, and that's why we have all these different languages now. And the people spread out then. And if we're talking about Old Testament history as covenant history, though, and that's what we've been talking about it as, you've got the fall of sin in chapter 3, and right away in chapter 3, you've got that promise of the Savior. The seed of the woman in Genesis 3:15. And as Old Testament history goes on, it gets more and more clear who this son is going to be. He's going to come from Abraham. So it gets clearer than when we get to Abraham. As we go through the period of the patriarchs then, he's going to be on that line of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And then in Genesis chapter 49, we're told that he's going to come from the line of Judah. So, closing that circle of promise even a little bit more. In Joseph's time, the people go down to Egypt, and the Lord is really working there because the Egyptians pretty much let the people of Israel alone so that they could grow as a nation, and they didn't mess with them as far as their religion was concerned. So, sort of the perfect spot for them to grow as a nation. And there were a long succession of pharaohs that remembered Joseph. But as the book of Exodus begins, once you get to a pharaoh that didn't remember Joseph anymore, then you have the oppression that comes. And mostly out of fear that, hey, this people's getting pretty big. And we're going to have a hard time keeping them as slaves. So, they make life miserable. The people cry out to the Lord, and the Lord hears them and sends them Moses. And Moses leads them through the Exodus, through the wilderness, which is where the books of... Exodus takes us into the wilderness, takes us to Mount Sinai, which is where Leviticus is taking place. And then Numbers, they get ready to go. And Numbers, if the people would have just trusted the Lord, they could have saved themselves about 40 years of wandering. But, of course, they didn't. And we get an idea sort of right away. Well, I mean, even in Exodus, we get an idea right away of the fact that the people all have that sinful nature that they gained from Adam. And it's going to be just this constant cycle of people turning away from the Lord and the Lord having to bring judgment on the people. But he brings judgment, of course, always so that he can bring them back, because he is going to keep that promise of bringing the Messiah through that seed of the woman, through the seed of Abraham, through that line of Judah. Those promises are made already, and God's going to keep them. So we go through this cycle then of the Lord having to reprimand his people with judgment so that they'll turn back to him in faith. You get the 40 years of wandering, which is mentioned mostly in the book of Numbers. By the end of Numbers, though, things are progressing and they're getting ready to go into the promised land. In the book of Deuteronomy, then, Moses gives the law again to that second generation of Israelites. But he's not allowed to lead them into the land because of a sin that he had committed back in the book of Numbers when he struck a rock and water came out of it, but didn't give credit to the Lord for it. And so because of his anger, his impatience, he's allowed to see the whole Holy Land, but he is not able to enter it. It's Joshua who takes his place then. And then the book of Joshua is about the conquest then. So if you see on the map there, where or on the timeline there, we're in about that period of 1406, somewhere, you know, somewhere right around 1400 is when the conquest starts. And in Joshua, there's really quick work of going in and taking most of the land and at least giving rest to the land to where the major enemies are defeated very easily by the Lord. And then the rest of Joshua is the whole distributing of the land to the 12 tribes. The land hadn't all been taken yet, but it's distributed in faith, and Joshua leaves the people with this promise, basically, that if they follow the Lord, they absolutely are going to have this land, because if the Lord is fighting for them, there's nobody that's going to fight against them. So the book of Joshua ends on this very happy note, then. The book of Judges, not so much. The book of Judges takes us through at least seven different cycles of the people disobeying the Lord, God bringing judgment, the people repent, the Lord sends a judge, the people are delivered. And then that deliverance lasts for a while until the people again do evil in the sight of the Lord, and then the cycle repeats itself. By the end of the book of Judges, which this is the one date that's not right on this, this should be about 1,000. By the time we get to the end of the book of Judges, we see that the Philistines have taken over most of the land. Everyone was just doing as they saw fit in their own eyes, and things were just not going well at all. First Samuel then begins right at the end of the period of Judges, and Samuel serves as both a prophet and as the last judge then. And then he moves the people into the period of the monarchy. So in 1 Samuel chapter 8, the people demand a king. And Samuel cries to the Lord that he's so upset that the people have asked for a king. And the Lord reminds him, no, Samuel, they haven't rejected you, they've rejected me, is what God says. But God lets them have a king, but he makes it clear that God really is still the king, and this king is going to do only what God says. And so Saul is the first one, of course, that's anointed. That goes well for a little while, and then he starts doing his own thing. And you recall all of the different situations with Saul, and then David is anointed while Saul is still king. And Saul, you remember all of the business of Saul trying to kill David, even though David was nothing but faithful, but faithful to him. At the end of Saul's reign, he dies in a battle against the Philistines, and Saul's reign kind of ends as this failure. David is very much a great success because he's got a different heart from what Saul had. David, of course, had his own sins, of course. His sin with Bathsheba being the biggest one, and then his inability to control his family almost destroyed the whole nation. But he was a man after God's own heart. He was fully repentant of his sins, and he was one who followed and obeyed the Lord. So the Lord blesses his reign. He reigns for 40 years. The first 7 years he reigns only over the southern kingdom. For the last 33 years he rules over both Judah and Israel. Solomon follows, and that's the richest part of the richest time for the nation then. He's got a united kingdom for his entire reign, which was, I think, also about 40 years. 970 to 931. That sounds like about 40 to me. Pretty close. But Solomon, for all of his wisdom that the Lord gave him, ended up marrying foreign wives so as to make alliances with other kings around him. This was against the Lord's will. And the Lord prophesies that he's going to tear part of the kingdom away from Solomon. But because of the promise that he had made, that and we get in closer here. So David, of course, is a descendant of Judah. And so we find out that the Messiah is going to come through David. And because the Messiah is going to come through David's line, which is also, of course, Solomon's line, the Lord isn't going to tear all of the kingdom away from Solomon, but he's going to reserve Judah, that tribe, for Solomon. You get the division of the kingdom then. Rehoboam is the one who follows after Solomon, and the kingdom is divided because Solomon was pretty tough on the northern part of the kingdom, on Israel. And they pleaded with Rehoboam to go easier on them. Rehoboam said he's going to go harder on them. And they said, well, that's enough of you. So they get Jeroboam instead. And Jeroboam, his reign of the 10 northern tribes was blessed by God, but he quickly turned away from that. He got afraid mostly of the fact that Jerusalem was still in the southern kingdom and that people were going to have to go there to worship in Jerusalem, and he thought maybe he would lose control of his own kingdom if people are always going into the southern kingdom. And so he makes his own gods. He makes golden calves. He puts one in Dan, one in Bethel, and the northernmost and the southernmost point, here are your gods, O Israel. And every king after him in the northern kingdom follows after that same sort of idolatry to one degree or another. And you never have a good king in the northern kingdom. They're wiped out first. They get wiped out in 722 by the Assyrians here. The southern kingdom is sort of a mixed bag. You have a number of good kings followed by bad kings, followed by one king that sort of reforms the people, and then things go well for a while, and then you get some more bad kings. And then you get a good king that reforms, and then some more bad ones. You get kind of this wavy line is kind of how I would describe it. But it's a downward trending wavy line. Because there are some faithful kings and there's some faithfulness to God, they last a little longer. but eventually they get sent off to exile to Babylon in 586 BC. The exile is marked off then as lasting until 515 or 516 with the rebuilding of the temple. 20 years earlier than this date, you have people going back to start the construction of the temple, but the 70-year exile is marked off from destruction to rebuilding of the temple, basically. It's then in this post-exile loop then where we've been spending most of our time. That's where Ezra and Nehemiah come in, rebuilding the nation, not just rebuilding the physical structures, but also rebuilding the spiritual life of the people. And that takes us to the end of the Old Testament. Then, in 430 BC. And this is how the Old Testament ends. The last two verses of the Old Testament, Malachi chapter 4. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the great and awesome day of the Lord comes. And he will turn the hearts of fathers to their children and the hearts of children to their fathers, lest I come and strike the land with a decree of utter destruction. So the people are going to continue to be faithless, of course, because that's what we do. But here's the Lord's promise, that he'll send Elijah the prophet, which is going to be John the Baptist, who is going to prepare the way for the Lord, who's going to come, because if he doesn't come to save us, then we all deserve to be destroyed. But the Old Testament ends with the hope of that promise, which traces throughout this whole history. The reason Abraham is called is because the Lord has to choose some people through whom the Savior is going to come, and so he chooses Abraham. The reason he brings the people out of Egypt is because he had made a promise that he was going to give the people, well, he made that promise back to Abraham, that he was going to provide also for a land in which the Messiah was going to be born. The reason he bears with the people in the wilderness is because of that promise. The reason that he bears with the people through the period of the judges is because of that promise. And on, each one of these periods, the only reason the Lord doesn't abandon them is because of his promise. That's what Old Testament history is really all about. It's not really about anything else. As I mentioned right at the beginning of this study, Old Testament history is not history like we think of history otherwise. But it's a very selective history. And it's selected to show how this promise goes on. It gets clearer who this Messiah is going to be as time goes on. And it shows why God bears with this people. All because of his promise. And so that's where the Old Testament ends then, with those words of promise. Any questions on the entire Old Testament? All right, with 10 minutes left then, let's look just briefly at, I think I have quite a few slides on this still, but we'll go through them kind of fast. What happened between the Testaments? So we've got this 400-year gap, which is not the first time we have such a gap in the Bible. There's a 400-year gap between Genesis and the beginning of Exodus. So, but the way that the New Testament opens, you open up with talk of Greek and, you know, Greeks and Romans and Pharisees and Sadducees, and none of them were there at the end of the Old Testament. So how did they get there is kind of the question, which gives us a little of that background then as we start to look at the New Testament. So here's what happened, and I'm just going to try to go through this kind of quickly. So the Old Testament closes at a vital part of Israel's history. The Jews have just returned to Jerusalem following 70 years in Babylonian captivity. They were allowed to go home in 536 BC, in which the temple was rebuilt by 516 BC, starting the Second Temple period. That's how that's often referred to, First Temple period, Second Temple period. Thousands of Jews returned to their homeland at this time. Around 445 BC, Nehemiah arrives to help build the walls of the city, inspiring more Jews to return home. During Malachi's ministry in the 430s, he prophesied about the forerunner of the Messiah. Those are those words that we just read. When the Old Testament ends, Nehemiah is governor over Judea. While Ezra was in Jerusalem, he read the law, the Torah, and the Levites explained it. So this has to do with that spiritual revival again. The Jews as a whole tried to live as their ancestors did, observing the Sabbath and the rest of the law. The Persians allowed them to live according to their own laws as long as they paid taxes and lived peacefully. So they basically left them alone as long as they did those things. Judea came under the rule of Greece in 332 BC when Alexander the Great overcame the Persian Empire and so conquered Judah or Judea. Alexander's conquest was not solely to gain territory but to spread Hellenism. Hellenism was Greek philosophy and culture, the language too. That's why the whole New Testament is written in Greek, because of Alexander and his desire to spread this Greek thought, Hellenism. Alexander encouraged his soldiers to marry foreigners to help spread Hellenism. Greek thought influenced the world, whether by the acceptance of it or simply the interaction with those who had. Paul kind of runs into them in Acts chapter 17 in Athens. We had this in the sermon not too many weeks ago. The message of the cross being foolishness to the Greeks. So, anyway, Alexander the Great's kingdom was divided upon his death in 323 BC. His four generals divided the land, with the Ptolemies gaining control over Egypt and the Seleucids over Syria. These two generals became rivals over the land, with Judea being thrown into the middle of many battles because of its location. Syria and Egypt fought no less than five major wars over the next 150 years. A consequence was that Judea's control passed back and forth between them. This is kind of how it all broke out. So this was all Alexander's kingdom here. And then you see in Egypt is where the Ptolemies were, and then the Seleucids were all this area. But right in here is where Judah is. And so they would fight for that area. And this is, it's really a very important area. Because if you want to trade from here, anywhere down here, you want to control this. And so you have all these wars going on between the Ptolemies and the Seleucids. During this time, the Jewish population in Egypt grew significantly. It's because the Ptolemies treated the Jews much better than the Seleucids did. So you have a lot of Jews, instead of just going to Jerusalem, they go down to Egypt. The Jews had been in Egypt for centuries, but thanks to incoming immigrants, their numbers increased rapidly. Because of this, there are more Jews outside of Palestine than inside. Hellenism had taken root in Egypt earlier, and Greek became the native language of all the land. Hebrew was still spoken by some in Egypt until about the 2nd century, and then Hebrew basically disappeared. I think I heard somewhere that Hebrew is like the only language to recover, that totally went out of use, and then it came back in like the 9th century. Jesus and his disciples would have spoken a lot of Aramaic, which actually would have been picked up from Babylon, a very similar language to Hebrew, but not quite Hebrew. Though there would have still been Hebrew Old Testaments around. But most of the people would work from a Greek translation of the Old Testament known as the Septuagint. And interestingly enough, most of the quotes of the Old Testament in the New Testament are from the Septuagint, not from the Hebrew. Sometimes it's their own translation, but mostly it's from that.
So Septuagint is just the whole Old Testament, Genesis through the last one.
Malachi,
written in Greek.
Yeah, translated into Greek. Because everybody spoke Greek. I'm running out of time here, so I'm going to skip ahead. This is kind of a big deal here. You have the Seleucids gaining power. Their empire was in decline under Antiochus III, until Antiochus III came to the throne. He defeated the Egyptians and he took Palestine. Antiochus III became known as Antiochus the Great, or Antiochus Epiphanes, as he's sometimes called. He plunders the temple in 169 BC. The abomination that causes desolation. This was prophesied actually in the book of Daniel. This is going to happen. Anyway, he makes the Jews eat unclean food, as it says here. The Jews rebelled. They were defeated. The Jews rebel again in about 168 or 167 BC after Antiochus installs a graven image into the temple. A man named
Mattathias
led the revolt. He died shortly thereafter. One of his sons, Judas, named Maccabeus, or the Hammer, initially led the Jewish forces into further revolt. Judas Maccabeus was able to defeat the Syrian forces and succeeded in cleansing the desecrated temple. That is the subject of the Book of Maccabees. If you know any Catholics, this is part of their Apocrypha. Two books of Maccabees, and it describes this revolt that happened. We're out of time, but basically after this, there's a period here where the Jews are kind of self-governing. It's known as the Hasmonean dynasty. They're still kind of under control of somebody. Well, they made some peace with the Romans before the Romans came in and took over. But they basically rule these Hasmoneans until you get to I don't have the slide. It's about 63 BC when Pompey comes in and takes over Palestine and installs his own people in there. Where the Pharisees and Sadducees come from is during this time where they were living, and especially with this influence of Greek philosophy and things like that, it was this threat against the people. And so there emerged these people who were very interested in studying God's word and in trying to remain separate. So one of these groups is the Sadducees. They were concerned with the temple's rituals. They saw little need for more commentaries on the Torah. They were characterized by their lack of focus on spiritual. They instead relied simply on the rituals and the customs. That's why it's said in the New Testament about the Sadducees that the Sadducees don't believe in the resurrection, because they didn't have any use for anything spiritual. The Pharisees are just the opposite of that. They were more concerned about living this separated, holy life. And so they do this by adding more laws to the law so that they can make themselves holy in that way. And then the scribes work closely with the Pharisees. The scribes were the experts in the law. And the Sadducees and Pharisees and scribes come together. They form the great Sanhedrin. The word Sanhedrin simply means assembly. And it's into that. There are these other groups, too. The Zealots is one. Simon the Zealot, remember, is one of the disciples. You have these other groups, too. What sort of unites them all, though, is basically this hatred for Rome. Because when Pompey comes in, he feels like it's a great honor for him to simply walk into the Holy of Holies. And the Jews hate him, of course, for it. Because you're not supposed to go in there. And while the Romans, for the most part, leave the Jews to their own thing, they allow Judaism to be one of the legal religions of the empire. They really aren't treated well, and they hate the Romans something awful. And it's during this time that they put their hope in a Messiah who will come and overthrow the Roman Empire. Enter Jesus. And that's it. So, any thoughts then? Part of what I thought we would do, maybe, since we've done this Old Testament survey, and we have some time to think about this, we won't have another Wednesday Bible class until 19th of April. So, we have time to think about this, but I had kind of thought of maybe going through the book of Acts, which would give a pretty nice picture of New Testament history. We'll spend, of course, Lent going through, you know, all that led up to Jesus' death on the cross and his resurrection, and then, the book of Acts picks up right after that with the spread of the church then. And so that might be a good place to go. But think about it. You have all Lent to think about what you might want to do on Wednesdays. But that was kind of one idea. So, all right. Well, why don't we close with the blessing then. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen. All right. Well, it's good to be back with you. Makes coming back from vacation a whole lot easier when we can be around you guys. Isn't that nice?
That is nice, yeah.
What's that?
That is nice.
No, I don't mean it as sarcastic. We like being here, so we like being back. It's just not as warm here as there. Or as sunny. But we have the best summer ever. And it's 115 degrees down there in the summer. So we'll have our time too. announcements. I want to say thank you to Micah for handling the service on Sunday. Everything went just fine. Bible study go okay too?
Yes. Okay. Very interesting.
Good, good. So thank you, Micah, for doing all that. We are sort of back to normal schedule-wise then. We're going to be starting our new Bible study on Sunday on the Large Catechism. We're going to start with some comments on the preface. So if you have a Large Catechism, you can read through the preface. You don't need to, though. We're going to go through some of those opening remarks in our study on Sunday. By Sunday, let me know if you want a printed copy of it, and we'll make sure we get those to you. What else? I feel like I'm missing something. Think of anything? There's been some talk recently. I think we talked about it maybe a little bit at our last voters meeting, but there's been some talk about the organ and the condition of our organ. It's kind of been a little bit troublesome. Micah, I think, has fixed something on that with the speaker, but it's sometimes middle C doesn't play well, and that's kind of one of those keys that you hit a lot. So, I think what we want to do is after church on Sunday have just a very brief voters meeting, and just talk about moving forward. So at the voters meeting, we designated funds for the organ. We designated that CD, that is the organ fund. But now we want to talk about, what kind of process do we want to maybe go through in replacing that organ? So one thought was maybe that we should form a committee to look into it, but I'd like to have a voters meeting anyway, just to kind of discuss maybe what we want to do. Talk a little bit about what the condition of the organ is, and maybe Mary can even kind of tell us what that is, see how we want to proceed from there. So brief meeting after church on Sunday on the organ. Next week then, next Wednesday we begin with our midweek Advent services. Same time, 7:00. For those of you who come to the parsonage, and of course anyone is invited always, when we have our Advent or Lent worship services, those are the times where we'll have our soup or whatever other lunch or supper, you might want to have. So plan on, what do we usually do? 6, right? So 6:00 next Wednesday, we'll have something for soup. Probably means I have to make it because she has her Dale Carnegie thing, so she'll be there until she won't be walking in until probably 5 to 7. So, but you can have lunch with or supper with me anyway. So that'll be next week. I think that's it for announcements. All right. Well, again, it's good to be back. Lord's blessings on the rest of your week, and we'll see you all on Sunday. So, good night, everyone.